The Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan, 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com. It's often said that the only thing we learn from history is that we don't learn from history. And Danielle Park on jugglingdynamite.com has written an article proving that very concept yet again. Hey, Danielle, welcome back. How are you?
Hey, Kerry. Thanks. I'm good.
So you wrote this excerpt of the infamous Pecora Commission, which put out their report in 1934. And honestly, if you pulled the dates out, it could have been written yesterday.
Absolutely. And what I really find interesting or revealing is, you know, not only is there this laundry list throughout that report of findings that the committee came to after 2 years of public hearings where they cross-examined all the heads of major institutions and traders from the security exchange, from the, you know, all the inside firms, insiders at corporations, everybody was questioned. And on the record, they admitted incredible things, right? Incredible to anybody who's not from that world. And I think that what I find refreshing about that report is that in the judgment of findings, the court expresses a shock and dismay at the low level of ethics that are prevalent in the finance industry back in the 1930s, you know, this litany of things that were done that led to the crash and to all the problems that the society and the economy suffered afterward. And the court really expresses this repugnance and concern for what a shockingly horrible industry it is. And then you think forward to the case that, you know, you and I were discussing not long ago of the where the court found that, you know, that customer funds had been taken, the Sentinel Management
Sentinel,
Group case,
sure.
Right? Where they're talking about how they go through this similar, frankly, a survey of facts where in the modern day court says, you know, the bankers took the money of the clients. It was supposed to be segregated, but we're not going to say it was so repugnant as to deem overturning that as unethical in any way. That is the two polar extremes we are in today where, you know, we've really lost our way on any kind of ethical barometer. We've come to this sort of place where it's you screw me, I screw you. It's all fair and love and war. Or something. I don't know, in business, you know. So at least I liked that the judicial process was followed in the Pecora Commission, that they actually did this on the record. They actually allowed people to answer questions. They actually cross-examined them. All this, you know, the principles of free judiciary that we're accustomed to think are normal, and then came to this conclusion list. And if you read those conclusions out today, and I only put a few of them on the blog today, Kerry, it's like verbatim what we have been saying for the last several years about the state of finance in the world today. And he goes on after that and says, by the way, you know, the bankers have been out on the streets crying that these changes, the reforms that we need to make, will bankrupt them, will stop the flow of commerce, will bring the economy to its knees. You know, none of that is justifiable. None of that is in fact true. And, you know, what have they been saying lately, Kerry? You know, all the efforts towards reform, you know, you've got the Jamie Dimon and company, you know, just screaming it out that if we do this, we don't know what we're doing, we're destroying, you know, the engine of the economy and all this nonsense. And, you know, the exact players, who was cross-examined in that 1933 and 34 hearing, but J.P. Morgan, sure. Goldman Sachs was outed as a notorious culprit of unethical behavior, shockingly unethical behavior, that threw their clients under the bus repeatedly, rape and pillage, taking profits, were they, promising to do the right thing and give advice and, raping their clients at the back. So sure. It's just, there you go. If you want a mirror held up, we've got it again. And, I think we just need to, as I say sometimes, we all make mistakes. We humans are frail and full of foible, but for heaven's sake, we must admit, repent, and, finally get on with the reforms needed.
That's for sure. But, in all honesty, this mania and this greed gripped every level of society. So, yes, these fiduciaries were in a position to do more harm than most, but this was a systemic, endemic, societal trend that took place, and it's only when everybody gets their noses bloodied that reform is ever seriously looked upon. And yet we see that, looking at history, government can't protect you. You can't count on government to look after your rights and stop the fraud from occurring, can you?
Well, you can't look at, you can't throw up your hands and give up on all personal responsibility, for sure. Individuals have to try and make sound decisions and not succumb to greed in this, everyone for themselves mentality that sweeps through history in different phases of it. But I think that, the reforms, it's like as a parent, okay, this is the way I look at it. Not everyone has the same information. Young people coming up do not know what has been tried and true in business and what truths have been found to be accurate repeatedly through time, okay? They don't know that coming out of, the womb. So they look to people ahead of them, just like we teach people, about technology or about, we created the wheel and we pass down this information so that each generation doesn't have to start from scratch again. And I think that when it comes to the systems that are in place and the banking sector as an example, everybody doesn't know what's naturally wise or prudent when it comes to controls in the system. And so they look to those ahead of them, whether they be in age or education or position, to offer them some sensible guidelines. You go to your banker in the old days and you say, can you give me some advice? And at different periods in time, depending on the, maybe it's partly the ethical fabric of the time, but I think it's also the wisdom of the participants. And some of that wisdom comes from spectacular blow-ups and remembering that, what went wrong. And then you have to look to policy at some point. We cannot have a free-for-all where it's every person for themselves and everything's allowed. Look at what's going on with the public exchanges today, Carrie. They are all about, and this was, by the way, it's all in that report as well in the 1920s. It was all about what was best for the profits of the exchanges in terms of churning and wild speculative practices, and nobody felt it was their job to, monitor or control or restrain any kind of speculative activity. So they all paid the price in the end. And that's where we are today, I think, because you look at, the participation in capital markets is so thin today, the volumes are so weak, and the reason is there's a profound lack of faith in the let's call them the highways of commerce. So because you have this high frequency trading, speculation, madness going on levered money, flipping in and out, millisecond trades, canceling after the fact, all with the appearance of volume, but in fact it's a complete mirage because the volume evaporates the instant someone needs it, right? So mm-hmm. You've got that kind of stuff going on. Well, if that's what the exchanges want to do, if they want to no longer be a utility of the economy, if they want to be a casino of recklessness, then fine. But the rest of society will slowly but surely not participate in that, and they'll be left only with that crazy speculative volume. And maybe then we need to go up here and create a new exchange, which is on some reasonable premise. So, you know what I mean? You can let people just swing for the fences and do whatever they want, but at some point you're going to crowd out legitimate business activity. And I don't think that serves democracy or, you know, capitalism or any of that.
Well, I will run this by you. The fact is, if I want to go set up a honest stock market tomorrow called Kerry's, you know, curbside stock market, all right? And I'm going to give everybody a fair shake. And in fact, you will only be able to list on my exchange if you go way, way beyond what the SEC requires. Guess what, Danielle? I can't do it because I can't get your government to allow me to do it. Because let's face it, all exchanges are today are government granted franchises. All right. So if the government really wants to help you, then they should let many different exchanges enter and let the best man win, and then seek to rout out the fraudsters and keep the honest exchanges there, protect people's rights rather than trying to dictate the nature of how securities markets trade. Because let's face it, you know, they've done a really rotten job of it now, and we've just got a den of thieves here. And if it was easier to set up your own exchange, I'll give you, for instance, there was a guy I knew who was one of the inventors of the ECN, Electronic Communications Network, which enabled companies to effectively set up their own exchanges that market participants were free to go to get better execution and lower prices. Do you know what happened? The SEC pretty much put him out of business because they kept cutting the amount of fees that he could get, to the point where he was able to charge less. He had to charge so much less than the going exchanges, the New York Stock Exchange, the American, whatever, that he couldn't make a living at it. That's what the government does. So seeking our salvation from the government, I don't know that it's going to work, because they got us into this mess in the first place.
Well, I agree with you, but in fairness, it's not a balanced mandate that the government comes at that stuff with. And that's what I think that the 1930s and 20s and 30s and now show you, that it matters very much how much the government, so to speak, or the institutions of the government are controlled and funded and restricted by the powers that be. So you had the financial conglomerate becoming incredibly powerful in the last 20 years, way more powerful than they ever should have got, having way more influence and completely lopsiding a system. So you had these monopolies that were controlling everything, and we're just trying desperately to break free of that undue influence today. And until we do, we'll never correct it back towards the center. And I'm not so naive as to believe we'll always be in the center, because history is a series of polarities, right? We'll go from this incredibly under-controlled, under-regulated environment to probably a quite tightly regulated environment. And it would be lovely if we could just stay in the middle somewhere, but we have these swings of behavior. So, you know, what I think you're going to see, and I think here's the thing. Last week we got the Federal Reserve's final upchuck, shall we say, of, mm-hmm. Oh my God, this is what we've got left. We're going to go for basically throw all the cards on the table, because we're tired of this pressure, this incessant pressure from politicians to say, don't worry, you know, let's look to the Fed. And I think the Fed finally said, you know, here, this is what we got left. We're down to our knickers. We've basically given you every other garment we have, and we'll promise to do this. But now back to you, Congress, you know, back to legislative changes that need to be brought in. If you're going to actually stimulate and try and restart, you have to correct the overindulgence of the last period. You have to put some lines back. Then you have to try and spend your money in areas that are going to actually stimulate. And I think that that's what's why you're seeing, you know, a disappointed stock market the last few days, because we no longer have that, you know, untold promises hanging over the heads of people who can blindly hope that somehow more liquidity is going to solve something of this nature, which it's not, of course. We've mentioned that many times. You need some actual bankruptcies. You need some insolvency. You need some admission that things can't be paid back. You need to knock off zeros. You need to restart the system. So I think that until the Fed's hand was finally played, people kept thinking, you know, at least they could game the system a while longer. Now, we had that huge run-up from, when was it, Draghi's comments, or, you know, at the ECB at the end of June, saying he could do unlimited things. Another ridiculous comment, right? We'll give unlimited funds to this thing. You could almost argue it had tones of what Bernanke said last week. We'll do this as long as we need to, except that there's no such thing, right? There's no such thing as an unlimited. There's no such thing as endless amounts of money. And they're up against that reality now. So I think, you know, it's one thing to bring out a QE program when stocks have already plunged 20% and the economy's weak. It's another thing to bring it out when stocks have already been goosed three times. They're at obscene valuations and the economy's now rolling over. You know, that omnipotent hand of the Fed is not having the control or impact that people have come to expect. And I think this is a great thing, because now we probably will get, you know, how do we get to the PCORA commission from here, which is where we need to end up, to a place where they finally, you know, admit, repent, reform, and recover? How do we get there? We have to have another major washout, I think. We have to show that the Federal Reserve is not actually in charge or control, that they don't have control over this system anymore. And once that's apparent, I think then you finally get the capitulation we're going to need to see that will bring the pressure, finally, political pressure and repugnance to say, oh my God, you know, we really can't back these bankers anymore, you know, and we'll get a full-blown hearing. We had shades of it in 08. Remember, they '09, they started into, you know, subpoenaing the heads and all that, but it really was such a feeble effort, and it really didn't go nearly as deep or as long as we needed to.
Wasn't heartfelt. It was just a means of a cover-up.
It was
and,
a show.
Yeah, and just one final thing. Bankruptcy, the definition is you're insolvent. You have debts that exceed your assets. Expenses exceed your income, all right?
And no reasonable prospects of servicing it.
Exactly. And you go to court, and they don't say, you know, if you just took out some more debt, if you only got another credit card or maybe two or three more credit cards, some personal loans, refinance your home, which is already underwater, take more money out of it, that will make you solvent. That's not what bankruptcy courts do. They extinguish debt. They sell off assets that can be sold off for the benefit of creditors. And then you get your second chance. Your debts are forgiven and you go on. And until we do that, there is no hope of the system ever righting itself. We're toast. And QE3 just puts off that eventual day of reckoning that much further. And when it does come, it's going to really be messy and catastrophic. So I think that's what we're up against, Danielle. But we're going to find out more in the next couple of months as people see that QE3 fails just the way that QE1 and 2 and 2A and 2B, C, D, and E failed as well.
That's right. I think so. And I think, you know what, it might happen sooner than people are expecting, because I've noticed the bullish sentiment out of the last round of QE. The expectations were so high. The even some bears in the crowd were throwing in the towel. You know, the shorts went got totally out. And you see this, I think the bullish sentiment investor surveys is like 55% today. You know, even people who I respect in the last few days, I've seen them going, well, I guess if the Fed wants things to go higher, it'll go higher. You see, we're conditioned like Pavlovian dogs, right? You know, because we got the QE1 slap people that weren't expecting it, and you got this big bump in assets. And then just as things were rolling over, you got QE2 out of the blue, and everyone, oh, wow, and up it goes. But QE3 was really, really a telegraphed, expected, you know, counted on. And I think you're just going to be disappointed if you think it's going to have a large and lasting impact this time.
I totally agree with you. Couldn't agree more. On that note, Danielle, jugglingdynamite.com, and we will talk to you in a couple weeks.
Okay, Carrie, be well.
Hey, you too. Bye.